the Velociraptor has changed a lot. In just the few decades since Jurassic Park made it one of the most popular dinos in the world, there have been lots of scientific discoveries that have changed how we picture it. Let's go on a tour of the Velociraptor's family glow-up, or glow-down, if you like the classic look.
Oh my goodness! Oh, I forgot about this guy!
This is how Velociraptors went from bipedal genius lizards to giant killer chickens.
Hi, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic. Today we're going to talk about Velociraptor and some other Dromaeosaurids, and how we've perceived them through time.
When you think of dinosaurs, one of the first names that comes to mind is Velociraptor. Sharp teeth, dagger feet, and probably a pretty bad attitude. If you're afraid of geese or even cassowaries, this was an animal that would spook you out of your undergarments. And yet, despite their current fame, their whole family, the Dromaeosaurids, were basically ignored for decades after their discovery. So let's take a look at the whole family and see how our vision of them has changed over time, and how they have been at the forefront of what we think of dinosaurs as a whole.
All right, so let's take a peek at the first fossils of Velociraptor that were ever found. Oh, what a beauty. So I've only ever seen a cast of this skull, but this is like the Velociraptor skull that you probably all imagine if you've ever seen a Velociraptor skull. Since then, there's been others collected, but this is the iconic one. It's a little surprising that this didn't make a bigger splash at the time, because look at this thing. It doesn't really look familiar like any other creature that we have alive today. Kind of bird-like, kind of lizardy. All dromaeosaur, baby.
The earliest fossils of this family go back to the 1920s. Velociraptor mongoliensis was discovered in, you guessed it, Mongolia. It was described by Henry Fairfield Osborne in 1924 based on its skull and claws. He was the same guy who named the Tyrannosaurus Rex, a real dino marketing genius. At the time, they just assumed they were basically small versions of more well-known theropods, like T-Rex and Allosaurus. Those first fossils led to the very first scientific illustrations of a Dromaeosaurid.
Oh, wow. Okay, so here's a beautiful, classic scientific illustration of the skull and the claw as described by Osborne. Yeah, this is all the material that they had at the time, so it was probably extremely difficult to try and imagine what kind of creature this came from. You know, today, we have claws that look similar to this. There's cat claws, bear claws, even eagle talons look a fair bit like this. But the size and shape of this is basically unseen until now. And this skull, if it belonged to this skull, good luck filling in the blanks. You know, other dinosaur claws had been found, but these are very, very distinctive. Something only dromaeosaurs have is that sickle claw. And, you know, at the time they thought, well, this is just dino scissor hands.
And that made sense at the time. You don't see a lot of modern animals with feet daggers, unless you look at birds. But we were a few decades from that.
And that's basically the story of dromaeosaurs and Velociraptor until 1969. Velociraptor didn't have the rich history of being a movie star throughout the 1900s like T-Rex did. Really, he was definitely an underground kind of star. But don't worry, his time is gonna come.
In 1969, John Ostrom described a new dino called Deinonychus, based on fossils his team had discovered 5 years earlier. This discovery led to the first reconstruction of the Dromaeosaurids we fell in love with.
Oh, now this is the real deal. Or at least it was back in 1969. This illustration is by Robert Bakker, also known as Bob Bakker, who is one of the most famous paleontologists in America. So this here is a representation of Deinonychus, who's a cousin of Velociraptor in the same family. And looks like they've definitely filled in a lot of blanks because we've got everything from snout to tip of the tail. You can see instead of being a big lumbering lizard down on all fours and dragging its tail, this one is up and alert and sprightly and sprinting, and that tail is just like a rod that's creating balance for its entire body, and it is moving fast, you can see. And now we know what that big old sickle claw's doing. Outstanding. So I do have to say that this is pretty typical of the time as far as dinosaur interpretations would go, because instead of being covered in scales, it's kind of got like a lot of like skin folds, and it looks like a naked chicken. But at least we're getting closer to chicken. In fact, you even see that it's got a cloaca. And it's funny actually, because the one fossilized cloaca that we have, it's not from this group of dinosaurs, it's a protoceratopsid. And that's the only fossilized cloaca we have, but it actually looks a lot like what you see here, including, okay, I'm gonna stop talking about his cloaca. Okay, I'm done.
Beyond telling where the claws actually went, just the fact that it looked like a sprinter put our understanding of them in overdrive. Sprinting takes a lot of energy and a high metabolism. Did that mean that they were warm-blooded? And the posture and claws were surprisingly bird-like. So connections were being made.
So in 1993, the best dinosaur movie to ever be made was released. And it had some pretty great Deinonychus depictions. Let's have a look. And by the way, this is called Carnosaur. Don't show your kids, but you do need to see it. Oh my God, that's amazing. Like, yeah, he's definitely not just a guy in a suit. Did you see how his lips were like curling up at the sides? So this might be a little bit of a step back 50 years to the man in a suit dinosaur depiction, but man, it's got 90s style all across it. And for that, I love it. But also, how many dinosaur movies are depicting Deinonychus specifically? Props to this movie. Seriously. They did their research and did nothing with it.
The same year, Steven Spielberg released Jurassic Park. Do we really need to say anything about it? That movie is simply undeniable.
Crazy to think that that's the precursor to what we all know and love. And if you don't, then why are you watching this video? Now, who could possibly be opening this door? Oh my God! Looking a little less like a man in a suit over here. We've got Jurassic Park. Now these raptors, as you all know, I don't need to tell you, you already all know this, that these are called velociraptors despite clearly being Utah raptor-sized. But when it comes to the movie, you know, things get a little changed and edited and inflated. So you've got a Utah raptor-sized Deinonychus called Velociraptor. Because that's just how things go sometimes. And you can kind of understand why without even asking. Velociraptor just sounds cool. Go Raptors. I can tell you, and I know a lot of paleontologists because I've been working in a paleontology lab for over 10 years, that a lot of dinosaur researchers these days were indeed inspired by Jurassic Park. So, say what you want about their inaccuracies, they've still inspired an entire generation, and I bet you own at least one t-shirt.
This look was iconic, but the next big development in paleontology was just around the corner.
In 1999, we got the first definitive evidence of Maniraptor and dinosaurs having feathers. And this does mean Velociraptor too. So this is Sinusaurpteryx. It's a mouthful, but it's also a featherful. We've got this entire body and it looks like it's just dancing. But that is kind of just a classic death pose for theropods. Ugh. It almost looks like it was alive yesterday and got run over by a truck.
Beyond showing us that some dinosaurs had feathers, this fossil proved that they weren't originally intended for flight, but for insulation or as a display. That meant that even larger dinos that couldn't fly could still have feathers. And it was concrete proof that birds are modern-day dinosaurs.
And just 1 year later, in the year 2000, we got Microraptor. Now this was a four-winged dromaeosaurid dinosaur. Oh wow. This is just like, what if angels were real but also a dinosaur? That's how you get Microraptor. There's such an interesting question of like, how would this animal move? Could they truly flap and fly? There are a lot of like physical demonstration and models that have been developed to test their flight abilities and whether, you know, they had to jump from high up in a tree or if they could take off from land. And these guys in particular, among the dromaeosaurid family, I think they're extremely fascinating.
And not only were they incredibly cool, these fossils were also screaming at us, "Oi, dinos could fly, and birds are dinos." The feathers were asymmetrical, which is something we see today in birds. They also had hollow bones and iridescent black feathers, like a starling. The bird connection was clear.
We don't have any other vertebrates that have four wings. This is something that dinosaurs tried, and it ultimately failed, but they're the only ones who did try it.
So how did pop culture react to these groundbreaking discoveries? Unenthusiastically.
All right, we're gonna watch a clip from Jurassic Park 3. Ooh. So you see he's got quills, or spines, I suppose, down his head. And so these raptors are looking more decorated, you could say. You know, I'm a fan of some speculative biology and speculative anatomy. Like, have you looked at a chicken before? They're covered in all kinds of strange structures that wouldn't preserve with the bones anyway. You'd never guess. But yeah, so this is as far as they went with Velociraptor, with trying to represent the presence of feathers in this group of dinosaurs. I think it would have been a little more interesting, at least to me, and I think to a lot of people, if they had tried to reflect some of the current knowledge. Because in the first Jurassic Park, they really did try and reflect what was known at the time. But, you know, cinema!
But then, in the year 2007, quill knobs, little bumps in the bone where some feathers attached to, were found in a fossil of a Velociraptor. That's it! Velociraptor and its cousins had feathers. There was no longer any controversy, right? In 2013, Walking with Dinosaurs 3D showed Truodon, a close relative of the Dromaeosaurids, in a very bird-like fashion.
Oh my goodness! Oh, I forgot about this guy! Oh, look at him! He's just a little chicken! Oh, he's beautiful and I love him. Walking with Dinosaurs 3D. Oh, I love this depiction, honestly. It's so fun. And they actually covered Truodon in feathers. It's beautiful. Still went with a scaly snout, but hey, vultures are naked on the front. Why not? So we don't know exactly why dromaeosaurids had these big feathers on their arms, but at least we know at this point now that they had them. And that's cool. I love it.
Okay, so was it time for the Jurassic Park franchise to catch up to dromaeosaurid research?
Jurassic World 2015, the originator of everybody's favorite Velociraptor meme format. And these Velociraptors are looking as lizardy as ever, but now they're just leaning into it. Like, they've established their universe and decided, well, this is what we're running with. Let's just get weirder. They're definitely leaning into the idea that these animals are intelligent. And you know, this is more of a mammalian kind of behavior. That's kind of interesting because, you know, the idea is that dromaeosaurids were pretty smart as far as dinosaurs go. Why wouldn't they have been a little bit social?
In 2022, they would course correct a little, finally showing a feathered dromaeosaurid. But it was unfortunately not a velociraptor. This was Jurassic Park Dominion.
All right, Jurassic World now. We've got everybody's favorite feathered depiction of raptors in the Jurassic World. And this scene, like, I'm not gonna lie, I ended up laughing pretty intensely because Pyroraptor just like digs into the ice and comes bursting through it like it was fluid. Oh my goodness. So it's basically like, okay, we gave it feathers, but now it's gonna be a killer penguin. This is great movie monster stuff though. Like, so for that, also the name Pyroraptor sounds even better than Velociraptor. Raptor of fire. Except this is like Raptor of ice. So I don't know. It's fine. I'm just happy that the franchise decided to actually do a feathered dinosaur.
But the same year, we got treated to possibly the greatest Velociraptor ever put on screen.
Oh, wow. Now that is a killer claw. To this day, I still think this might be the most scientifically accurate Velociraptor ever depicted. And I am a huge fan of it. It is beautiful. But also the fact that we've kind of discovered the extent of keratin that sheaths around the bone of that killer claw. And in claws in general, there's been a lot of discoveries that show just how much bigger the claw would have been on top of that bone. I've seen some myself. Sometimes it's like an extra third of the length is just keratin. And I think that this is actually showing that really nicely. That thick layer of keratin that tapers towards the point, absolutely terrifying.
And finally, we have 2025's Walking with Dinosaurs.
This is Utah Raptor versus Gastonia. And finally, Utah Raptor gets to be the star. Not only is it the biggest dromaeosaurid that we know about right now, I love that it's not moving its head, like its body is moving, but it's keeping its head perfectly stable, which is a very bird-like thing to do. You ever seen, or have you ever held a chicken and done this with its body, but its head stays in exactly one place? This Utah Raptor is doing the same thing, and that's really cool. So Utah Raptor is estimated to be up to 500 kilograms. And yeah, that is huge and really big, but Gastonia is estimated to be around 2,000 kilograms. So that's four times its weight. And it has the bonus of being low to the ground, supported by four legs instead of two legs. So I don't know. I don't know if I'm buying Utah Raptor pushing over a Gastonia. So there you have it. This is the history of how we've seen dromaeosaurs and Velociraptor through time. Pop culture has given us a little bit of everything, but science and new discoveries get us closer and closer to what they probably looked like every day. So, what do you think I should talk about next? Please let me know in the comments and don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching. See ya. Ah.